In this video, we're going to be taking a detailed look at SIPro, a new EM analysis tool suite for signal integrity applications. Let's begin by comparing these two eye diagrams. From the outset, they look very similar, but the one on the left has considerably less noise. So what's the difference between them? Well, the one on the left is considering typical SI concerns such as crosstalk, jitter, and impedance mismatch, whereas the one on the right also includes the effects of the power net, also known as VCC bounce, when considering DDR4 signals. We see that the overall signal quality depends on both the signal integrity and power integrity engineer's success. Let's dive in further by looking at the challenges in SI and PI as the data rate increases. From a signal integrity perspective, the first thing that we want to care about is skew between differential pairs. This skew matching now needs to be much more precise at higher data rates. And what that means is we need an EM simulator that can capture the coupling between these lines very accurately, especially when we enter into this meander or jog out, such that we get the exact electrical length at the entry to these vias. The next thing is paying careful attention to the design of vias themselves. Try to minimize the impedance mismatch between the traces as they enter, and try to make sure that we paid careful attention to the return current paths. This is increasingly difficult when we look at the IC pin field, where the choice of ground signal ground pairs means that crosstalk becomes a very difficult issue. Trying to get the fast signals out from inside a pin field to the outside of the board requires careful design and simulation. With higher density routing also comes the issue of non-ideal ground planes, and if one of our high-speed data signals does happen across a slot or cutout in a ground plane, then the impact on the signal quality will be much more pronounced. We need an EM simulator that's going to be able to capture these effects as accurately as possible. When it comes to power integrity, the higher data rates also means operating with lower voltages and therefore also lower margins. What we're showing here is the voltage distribution on a ground net. That's right, not everything is 0 volts on the ground net. And although we're talking about a very small amount of voltage distribution on the order of hundreds of microvolts, this is where some of the loss in our power net design is coming from. When designing the power delivery network, we also take care to make sure it stays below a target impedance value across the frequency range, as well as being resonance-free. We care about it being resonance-free because we don't want any energy that may get onto the power delivery network resonating or causing EMI issues. Densely routed boards also equate to higher current densities, and we can see where we have via clearances on this particular power net, the current is crowding together, causing a voltage drop and potentially causing thermal issues as well. We can also see that there's a large number of voltage rails to design for, and we need greater simulation coverage in order to make sure that each of these power nets is going to work as designed. We address each of these challenges with one cohesive workflow in ATS, whereby the SI engineers can work together with PI engineers, sharing simulation results, sharing simulation test benches, and should a failure in compliance occur, they now have a common language to be able to decide the best actions. The workflow focuses on delivering high accuracy and high productivity. The theme of the SI and PI challenges is such that accuracy matters, especially at high frequency. Let's take a case study example of this Xilinx Kintex Ultrascale FPGA and the evaluation kit that it comes with. This board is 16 layers and approximately 5 by 9 inches. On this board we have a host of high-speed interfaces. There's DDR4 running at 2400 megabits per second. We also have HDMI, small form factor pluggable, as well as PCI Express 3.0. You can see in black some of the highest speed rates that future technologies are going to need to support. And we can see that as increasing data rates, we also have a greater demand for accuracy at those higher frequencies. Generally speaking, finite element method is the EM technique most favored by the industry when we need high accuracy. It always comes at a price though. The user needs to cut away the board and then refine the layout, trying to simplify it as much as possible, reducing the number of layers to simulate, in order to get a simulation that's going to give you a result in a reasonable amount of time. Here we see the result of the simulation. S11 and S21 both look pretty good, but the cost is high in terms of simulation time and memory, as well as engineering effort. is about 54 minutes to mesh and 12 minutes per frequency point. Now we introduce SIPro, which is a new solver based on pure EM technologies. In fact, it uses multiple EM techniques in order to achieve both speed and accuracy. Comparing results to FEM, we see that we have very good agreement all the way throughout the frequency range. Also, it only took 23 minutes in total to solve this simplified structure, which is a fraction of the time and memory required for FEM. But the full story is that SIPro can handle this structure without any need to simplify it in the first place, without cookie cutting or spending engineering effort in order to prepare the structure for simulation. Let's now compare SIPro's accuracy to real measured data. Here we have a Xilinx DDR4 memory characterization board. It has 28 layers in total, and the measurements were made at Gigatest Labs. The trace that we're probing is the DQ29 data line, and we can see from the simulation results that SIPro matches extremely well to measurement. It's even picked up the resonant frequency of the VIA stub correctly. We'll now begin our demo. From within ADS, we launch a single window for SIPI setup, and inside we have a power-aware SI solver, SIPro, and three focus solvers for PI, known as PIPro. When finished, we take the EM models back into the schematic to perform higher-level simulations. We begin in ATS Layout, where as you can see, the board has already been imported. The process is to import from a variety of file formats, including Cadence's .brd file or ODB++. Now we can go to the Net Navigator window and we can highlight some of the nets of interest, which in this case is the bus of PCI Express data nets. When I zoom in on the detail, we can see that we have the ability to interact with any of the artwork. We could draw something new, or for instance, we can adjust the width of this particular trace. Then when we're ready, we can press the SIPI button, and the SIPI window opens up. The first thing you'll notice is it's a complete three-dimensional visualization environment. We can search for the nets, just like we did in the layout, and these are the ones we're going to be adding through to our analysis. But if I highlight them here, we can now inspect these traces in full 3D. So to make it easier to view, I've just hidden the rest of the geometry. And if we zoom in, we can clearly see some places where the DC blocking caps will be. Next, if I right-click, I can add these traces to an analysis. And then if I selected all of those, I can right-click and say Create Ports. And this is the beauty of the tool. You can see that it's smart enough to recognize what is likely to be a port and what is likely to be a component that's connected in series between two of the nets of interest. And it gives us the appropriate option. We also get to select which is the ground reference, and it uses this information to place the plus pin and minus pins appropriately so that our EM ports are already set up ready to go. It really is less than 20 clicks in order to be able to set up this simulation. We can then see how the EM ports have been set up with the plus pins placed on the signal gold fingers and the minus pins placed on the neighboring gold fingers that would be ground. After clicking on the options, we see that we've got a linear sweep that's set up between DC and 20 GHz with 101 frequency points. The only thing left to do is hit run and wait for the simulation to finish. We can then press the one button, Generate Test Bench or Generate Subcircuit to create our schematic. Now again closer to our final objective. Here we've taken the EM characterization of the channel and placed it in a schematic between a transmitter and receiver. You'll notice that the adjacent channels have been terminated in an ideal impedance. And we want to evaluate the quality of the eye at the output of this link, which may be figures of merit such as eye height and eye width. The output of the simulation is a sweep of different data rates. Here we can see that by the time we get to 8 gigabit per second, as needed for PCI Express Gen 3, we still have a very reasonable eye shape. But by the time we get to 16 gigabits per second, the channel has degraded the signal completely. Although I would argue that with appropriate TX equalization, as well as receive equalization as per the spec, we'd be able to recover this eye accordingly. Let's take a look at another high-speed interface on this board. Here I'm selecting four nets, which are the transmit and receive differential pairs. When we zoom in, we see that it begins on one side of the board and then transitions through onto one of the lower signal layers in order to keep the via stubs short. Now in the schematic, we place the EM model and we have a crosstalk component which is terminated in its ideal impedance, and the transmitter is on the other side and we're looking at the output of the receiver. Here we see the impact that crosstalk is making on this particular design. So far we've only looked at high-speed serial links. Now let's take a look at a memory bus on the same board. Here I'm having a look at 2-byte lanes of a DDR4 memory bus. We're including the data and the data strobes, and we can see how it's been laid out from the FPGA directly over to one of the soldered down DRAMs. Once the simulation is finished, we then go back into schematic and take a look at the DDR bus simulator across these nets. Here we have ideal transmitters and ideal receivers, and we're running a simulation to see how much of an impact the channel itself has on the eye. We can see from the results that there is quite a significant difference between some of the data lines. DQ2 and DQ6 look to have significantly more noise on the eye density plot than DQ1 and DQ5. Why don't we go back to SIPro and see if we can use some of the tools in SIPro to understand where this variation comes from. DDR simulations are known for having a very large number of ports. Here I'm using the filters in SIPro to be able to just show me the data that I care about, which is the data signals DQ looking from component U1, which happens to be the FPGA. Now I'm plotting DQ2 and 6 and DQ1 and 5 and comparing the results. And we can see that 2 and 6 definitely have a little bit more loss than DQ1 and 5. But that's not the whole story. Let's go and have a look at the near end and far end crosstalk for DQ5. And then we can go and do exactly the same thing for DQ1 as well. And we have a look and see that at about 4 GHz we have about minus 20 dB of crosstalk. So that's something which we'll try to remember. Now let's go do the same thing for DQ2. We can see that it has significantly more crosstalk. If we go take our cursor over it, we see there's about 4 to 5 dBs higher crosstalk. Next, if we have a look, we can see which is the offending pair, and in both cases you can see that it's DQ2 coupling to DQ6, both at the near end and at the far end. So let's take a look at this in the geometry and try to understand why. Looking into the geometry, we can see that DQ2 and 6 happen to be located close to each other on both the DRAM side and the FPGA side. And it's the coupling between the vias as well as the traces which is giving that high level of crosstalk. Should we be worried about this crosstalk? Well, if we go back to the DDR bus simulation and replace the ideal TX and RX with the realistic IBIS models, we can see that DQ2 and DQ6 definitely do have more noise and less margin than DQ1 and DQ5, but in general, everything looks pretty good. One further question to investigate is how much the power delivery network plays a role in the signal integrity of this memory system. Here we've got a channel in the center created from SIPro that contains both the data lines as well as the power delivery network. Then we run a transient simulation using IBIS models that are power aware, and we can definitely see that DQ6 now has less margin than before, and this is with a simulation of 500 bits only. A compelling feature of SIPro is this ability to simulate the ground, power, and signal nets all together in one EM simulation. This means that coupling between the signal and power is captured, particularly in the pin field arrays where we find most of the coupling occurring. Let's recap. ATS delivers a cohesive workflow for the design and analysis of high-speed channels, beginning with design exploration, what we call pre-layout, with world-class channel sim and transient sim technologies. We then move to post-layout verification with EM techniques such as we described in the video. The EM model is then brought back into schematic and we perform a final compliance test. SIPro EM technology focuses on delivering both high-frequency accuracy at a practical speed, whilst SIPro and PIPro together were designed with great usability in mind. Finally, as we discussed at the start of the video, power integrity does play a significant role in the quality of a link. The ability for PI engineers to share current designs, simulation setups, and data with SI engineers aids to speed design optimization. Thank you very much for watching.